The 486 was a very long-lived platform, and it was around for the introduction of features such as the PCI bus and clock doubling, which became very important in the preceding years. Of course, today, the 486 platform isn't really around so much. You can't just go in a store and buy one like you could do, say, 25 years ago. And, well, there's probably reasons for that, but did it die out quite as quickly as you might have thought it did? Well, hello everybody, I'm High Treason, and today we're going to have a look at a 486. It's quite small, and it's a little bit, well, it's actually rather unusual. However, yeah, well, I don't know. I guess we'll have to actually look at the thing to figure out what's going on there. It has just occurred to me while I'm recording this that this is the first time you'll be seeing me in 2017. This wasn't the video we were supposed to get, but God, I'm in so much trouble. So hard to work on a video in here. So yeah, what I was doing is on hold, it'll get done at some point. We'll do this one instead. And yeah, I mean, it's 2017, right? I mean, that warts some of my feelings on that, I think, really. But yeah, you know, no doubt a million more things are going away making videos, and we'll probably get outstripped by channels that make things, you know, videos about dismantling lamp holders and LEDs again, because I guess that's the sort of things people want to see, isn't it? Anyways, let's get on with this crap before it runs any more late.
This is an iTalk Star motherboard. It belongs to a small industrial computer, which I don't have, but I know the cases were small, cuboid, and utilitarian, which appeals to me greatly, and I would like to find one. At first glance, you might wonder what the board does, and upon realizing it doesn't really connect to anything else, you might be forgiven for thinking it was a simple backplane without closer inspection. Then, upon discovering it's a motherboard, you'd probably wonder which processor it uses. The BIOS label gives away that it uses a 486 processor of some description, which it sure doesn't look like, but you'd then have to think it was quite old if it uses a 486, surely. Well, it is quite old, but the ATX power connector gives away a hint that it may not be quite as ancient as you would have first thought. The parts are binned from a wide range of date codes on mine, so the exact date that it was made is unknown. From what I can tell, this board could have been made as early as 1999 or as late as 2009. The manufacturer appears to be a branch of Diamond Flower Incorporated, or DFI. You might have heard of them. They used to make some really high-end gaming motherboards when the AMD Athlon was around, but probably the majority of their income was from their industrial products under the DFI ACP name. Gaming boards always were a bit of a niche, especially back when this whole gaming computer nonsense wasn't such a big thing. Still, the more you look at the board, the more you start to think something very unusual might be happening. Firstly, there's no chipset, so there goes any idea that it might use one of those QFP processors from budget motherboards like that one type of Intel 486SX that seems to have lasted for quite a long time. Also, why do I plug in the keyboard? And why is there a chip missing here? That can't be good. Well, if you know your 486 processors, you will be well aware that SGS Thomson used to manufacture them. They weren't ST's own design. They were Cyrix processors that had been relabeled. You see, Cyrix didn't have the facilities to fabricate their own chips, and contracted them out to other companies, notably Texas Instruments, IBM, and, of course, ST. So as part of the deal, these companies were then allowed to rebadge the Cyrix as their own. The manufacture and sale of Socket 3 chips really started to die out in the mid to late 1990s, as the market for them was fading very quickly. The Pentium MMX was doing well by that time, and the K6 was about to take off massively. Pentium 2 systems were really for rich people early on, but they did quite well too, so the measly 486DX wasn't really needed for home or office computers anymore. Nonetheless, ST made use of their license and produced the chip under that heatsink. This is the 66MHz version, but a 133MHz version does exist somewhere in the world, at least according to the datasheets. Over the years, processor die sizes shrank drastically. To many, the primary advantages of this are that you can make the processor more efficient, because it's smaller, and therefore you can add more parts, and in all likelihood, make it go faster. But there is another big advantage, and one that has become increasingly relevant today in small form factor computers, and that is integration. The processor is only a small part of that chip. Inside the plastic BGA package, there are a number of things which make the processor oddly ahead of the curve. Firstly, the lack of a chipset is because that is not really needed. It's contained inside the STPC package itself. Pretty much everything's inside that one small chip. The memory controller, PCI interface, ISA, VGA adapter, an LCD controller, much of the clock generator circuitry, what is essentially a Visa local bus host adapter for the IDE interface, temperature, fan and power monitoring circuitry, you name it, there's a lot going on in there. Other models of the chip even offered Ethernet, USB, JTAG interfaces, and several other features, so it really was pack-jammed, this thing. Essentially, it's a full-blown 486 computer on a single chip, aside from some of the Super I.O. chips which hang outside, as well as typical demuxer, glue logic type things that do nothing really special. It's kind of hard to find any electronic device that doesn't have a 74 series chip of some kind in it, or a GAL or something like that. You're always going to find one in there somewhere. There is a level 1 cache, but no option for level 2, at least not on my board, and I'm unclear as to whether this was ever offered, although I don't really think there would have been much need for it. So, essentially, this thing is an SoC, or system on a chip, and the iTalk Star is a single board computer. You might have noticed a mention of this if you read the Wikipedia article about the Cyrix 486. Most likely because I put it there when I wrote the article, so if you think I'm copying Wikipedia anywhere in here, well, it's still my own original work, technically. Nonetheless, the STPC is quite impressive. The whole chip uses less than 5 watts. Yeah, max rating of 4.8 for the 133 MHz version, and it does support advanced power management. In fact, the more you look at it, the more it appears oddly similar to processors like the Intel Atom and AMD A4, which came much, much later. Because, of course, in today's world, the level of integration and efficiency often outweigh the requirement for any performance. It's pretty unusual, then, when you think that this particular core here, this STPC, came out around the same time the Athlon was ascending to its rightful place as king. In today's world, the systems like the Strawberry Cake, or whatever the hell it's called, are immensely popular, and really all these things bear a strikingly resemblance to this STPC SoC. It's worth noting that Cyrix themselves had attempted the Media GX in 1997, but this failed to break any real ground. Architecturally, they're not immensely dissimilar, but I do think the STPC might have had just a slight edge on the integration front. And one thing in particular catches my eye, and I'll point this out towards the end of the video. Now, the missing chip I mentioned is quite fine to completely ignore. This is a solid-state drive of sorts, the M-System disk-on-chip solution. Yeah, I doubt it was a particularly fast solid-state drive, yet I could be wrong, I've not used one, I'd like to get my hands on one. It would certainly have gotten the kind of operating system this would have been running off the ground anyway. Probably QNX seems to be quite common on these, and I'm really going to have to play with this operating system because it looks absolutely fascinating. I haven't had time really to get to know it that well, but you know what? I think I really like this operating system. It seems pretty good. But going back to the machine, I doubt that speed was all that important for disk drives on this system. I mean, I could see these being used as thin clients anyway, and, well, the other thing, if you were using it in an industrial setting or somewhere where there's a lot of vibration and dirt, you wouldn't want a mechanical drive. So maybe the benefits of having a slower solid-state drive with less capacity really outweighed the cost. It might well have been a huge advantage in a setting like that, if that's what the machine was designed for. The board takes EDO RAM and fast page RAM. I've heard some only took fast page, and I've heard rumours that some took SD RAM, although I'm not entirely confident on that, and so I'm not going to say that they did. It certainly seems to do fast page RAM on all of them. Some boards likely had the memory soldered on and didn't offer support for modules at all, which would make complete sense, really. There is a living example today which does this using a very similar processor, and I'm going to show you that later on in this video. That aside, if we start the board up, nothing seems all that unusual, not until you look back at the board and remember it's a 486, and we're starting it with no peripherals plugged in. I'm not using them, but there are PS2 mouse options as well as two serial ports, and of course there's a parallel port if you want one, and an unused IR connector on my board. It's not populated, but it seems to be something you would be able to do. It uses a standard Winbond Super IO chip for a lot of this. The BIOS is very reminiscent of budget Athlon boards, right down to the system monitor, which, yeah, it seems really strange seeing temperature monitoring and fan tachometers on a 486 board. It even has a little thermal probe in the CPU heatsink that you can actually see there, which is like the ones MSI used to put underneath the processor on the K7. It's kind of neat. The main menu reminds me more of 386 era AMI biases, though. I guess they figured there was no need to design something new for this high flex BIOS when they already had a working concept. I've heard of something called Tiny BIOS, which some of these used to use. I might have to investigate that at some point. You could easily forget that this is a 486 in the submenus again, once you notice Ultra DMA support, CD-ROM, SCSI and network booting, hard drive smart capabilities, advanced power management, plug and play, and all manner of features that weren't even found on a lot of Pentium boards, let alone the average 486. Oddly, the power switch is still a toggle and not a momentary switch like most ATX boards. I'm just using this jumper on mine, that's how it came. It seems to be factory, so I'm not really sure what was going on there, but, well, it works, I guess. And, yeah, I just can't get my head around it being ATX. It just, that just seems really, really strange. I've very little on this hard drive, and I won't bother running games on it outside of the regular benchmarking, but it is a capable machine, and it should even get through quick, if not a little slowly, but it runs because the chip has a floating point unit. The datasheet indicates the CPU does not clock double, so the faster bus might actually help us out in places. Overall, though, it seems to perform identically to a Cyrix 486 DX2, which makes sense because, well, it is a Cyrix 486. And, yeah, it also indicates you're not losing much by the clock doubling on a Cyrix 486. I think the bus clock just differs over, you know, probably works out about the same. It's in performance, it seems. It's kind of neat to know, really. The 133MHz version does clock double, and I have to wonder how it compares to the Cyrix 5x86 at that speed. ST did claim that some versions of the SoC were Pentium class in the datasheets, but I have no way of knowing for sure without actually testing one, and I don't have one to test. On the other hand, I suppose I could argue that this is among the world's fastest single-clocked 486 systems. I mean, that's something to think about, along with how, for whatever reason, some old 486 boards could actually run at this speed. The MB4D UPM in my Pentium Overdrive can supply 60 and 66 MHz clocks through undocumented jumper settings. So perhaps this was actually planned at one point. Perhaps that's what Socket 6 was going to be, or maybe the Socket 3 boards just use the same clock generators as Socket 4 and 5 boards. The board makers probably saw no need to change a perfectly working circuit, and that's the only reason they can do it. It's just a leftover. I mean, it's a bit of a headache to sit and speculate about. I'd go with the latter option, being that they were just leveraging existing technology and say that the STPC is the odd one out, but who knows? I suppose I will run you through the benchmarking scores, but very quickly. As you can see here, Probably. Actually, you might not be able to. My capture card's not playing ball. Damn it. 3D bench scores 24.9, PCP bench scores 6.6, top bench gets 171, speed sys gives us 26.79 for the CPU, a memory bandwidth of 54.2, which is actually not that bad for a 486, L1 cache at 43.0, memory throughput of 19.14. Note the 9 MB per second VGA bandwidth there, this is going to be quite relevant shortly. Doom scores 14.4 frames per second, which is just about playable for me, but it's not great. And yeah, that's more than 5,000 ticks, man. That's kind of dragging a bit for a 486 at this speed. Quake on the other end takes 246 seconds. It gives us 3.9 FPS, which is too slow even for me to play on it. I don't imagine that being fun at all. Still, this is a 486, which is way below Quake's requirements, so, well, we're doing okay in reality. I seriously doubt it was meant to play Quake, so, you know, I think it would have been the last thing on the minds of the designers. Unfortunately, I can't show you much of that footage, as I said, because my capture card doesn't play ball with the onboard VGA. It's a bit odd, it displays garbage at the edge of the screen in Quake, but I'm not really worried, as, like I say, I don't think it was meant to do this kind of thing. The onboard VGA is quite slow, though. It makes use of UMA, which is... well, the memory count's a bit strange here. It's actually using the system RAM, 4 MB of it we've set it to use, which is the maximum, but you can set it as low as 128 KB. It defaults to 512K, so, yeah, I don't think performance was really what they were going for. It does offer some limited GUI features, but I haven't really been able to test those out, and there is an extension for DOS, sort of like S3VBE, so I guess it'd be STVBE. It may make it perform faster, but I've not really played around with it to see if it improves performance or compatibility, because I never use enhancements when I'm running these tests. I don't load memory managers or anything. We'd run them clean, so it would be unfair to do it just for this one system. So, yeah, I don't know that, but I don't think it would improve that drastically, as I honestly don't think the card was ever designed to do this. Now, you can see in SpeedSys that this is not a regular VGA solution anyway. It appears ST made it themselves, or else licensed something from somewhere. I do find the video controller, the quite interesting for those reasons I said I shall discuss later, and I will, honestly. The motherboard misidentifies in SpeedSys. I've no idea on that. I mean, this definitely wasn't a Socket 7 FIC board last I checked. The PT2200 does look pretty nice. I think that's a 430TX, isn't it? Well, thanks for letting me know about that, SpeedSys. You know what, I hope my German viewers don't think I'm swearing at them when I say FIC. Anyway, I'll test again with an S3 Trio 64V+. It's the one I used in my K5 in the next gen video. Oddly, I think this is the one that came with this board. I think I may have another one of these somewhere, so I'm not entirely certain now. But perhaps the previous owner needed faster video as well, or else just shoved it in because they were either missing the VGA header or else completely unaware of its existence, as it's at the front of the board. A little bit strange. I'm sure it fit in the case that these were designed for. Anyway, here's the results. 3D bench gets 40.8. Drastic improvement. PCP bench, 11.5. Top bench, 182. SpeedSys, 26.79, which is identical. I'm starting to like SpeedSys. It seems to break the tests up very, very well. Though the rest of the system does get quite a boost. Level 1 is at 56.01, and memory bandwidth improves to 108.9, which is very significant and actually quite quick. VGA now measures 12 megabytes per second, so that's an extra 33% over the internal graphics, and the memory throughput is about double, that's 39.45, which, yeah, really not bad at all. I think with level 2 cache, this thing would actually be really fast, but it's sure as hell capable as it is. It's also worth noting, I suppose, that the IDE interface is really fast. I mean, that's not even a very good hard drive. That's a busted Seagate Barracuda I used for testing AMD Athlons, which I think this model was actually known for having problems, so, you know, it's still running. But nonetheless, yeah, I guess that's what large drive support and Ultra DMA and features such as that will do for you. Well, that looks quite promising. I kind of wonder how fast they'll actually go. Doom now yields 22.56 frames per second, and Quake can finish the demo in 154 seconds at 6.3 frames per second, which is almost twice as fast before, maybe about 33% faster. I can't bother to work it out, but yeah, it's a significant improvement. Check CPU also identifies this CPU as a Cyrix 486. Just thought I'd point that out. I mean, that's certainly not really inaccurate. It does indicate the single clock correctly, which just looks weird to me, being used to the DX2. I was going to show you the tests from a real Cyrix DX266, but there's no point, as if I disable level 2 cache and use the same configuration, the margins are so small that it's just not worth it. In fact, some of the tests are pretty much identical, which, as we know, isn't really a surprise because, well, the core of the STPC is a Cyrix 486. Though, of course, it does have some advantages and disadvantages. You know, we have Ultra DMA, but we don't have cache, things like that. I suppose it may be worth pointing out how similar the machine kind of is to that Leo system that I've got, but the component count and power use in this thing is much lower. This thing definitely dissipates less power than that AMD 486 and the chipsets and everything, the video and the hard drive that are in there. That thing actually runs quite warm. I can't say much remarkable about actually using this thing, though, which is actually a good thing, because to all intents and purposes, it really does just behave like any other 486. In fact, I think if I put a Cyrix in that Leo system, I wouldn't notice the difference if you hid them under the desk and didn't show me the purse screen and remove tools from me that could detect such things, because you know I'd run them. Expansion cards work, software works, it does as it's supposed to do, and the only weird things that happen are when software can't identify something correctly. Like SpeedSys thinking I have a 13MHz 486 on that FIC motherboard. Sorry, Germany. Supposedly, there are some operating systems with support for the STPC natively, though it doesn't seem to add much of anything new to the architecture, so I'm really doubtful this was particularly complicated thing to do compared to supporting a new or more advanced processor. For the most part, I'd imagine it probably reports a generic 486 processor to applications or some such to prevent them identifying it incorrectly and refusing to run or going wrong. That would be about it. I don't think it would do anything really in depth, let's put it that way. However, as I did mention, QNX, and yeah, QNX had support exclusively for the STPC. It's a recommended operating system for it. Seems to have ventured into all kinds of fields, industrial, medical, cars. I don't think the STPC ever made it there, but yeah, we'll come back to QNX shortly, because it's quite interesting culmination of events that seems to have happened. So, it appears the STPC platform was moderately successful, which, in all honesty, doesn't surprise me at all. This would have been ideal in a thin client situation, anything which required low power, hard wiring. An industrial setting it would have been absolutely brilliant for, especially with the MDisk disk-on-chip device there. There's no mechanical drive to be affected by dust and dirt and vibrations. The STPC is, of course, old and inefficient now, and it was retired some years ago, but the market's still there in some capacity, and similar devices even exist now. You can still buy them. New, yeah. Think about that. A brand new 486 machine in 2017. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this is probably just the latter I would imagine around here, but who knows. I give to you the ZF-X86 made by ZF Micro. This processor is similar in concept to the STPC, essentially giving you a complete 486 DX system in a single chip, consuming less than 1 watt. What you have to understand is that the industrial market is very different to the consumer market that you're more than likely used to. Although I would appreciate input from people who've worked with such things, as my experiences with them are limited, and whilst I have worked with them a little, I'm from more of an office background with these things.
Now, it's probably fair to warn you, I'm pretty much done talking about the STPC specifically, and you're about to get a major earful about basically computers that aren't for the consumer market. And yeah, there's some fairly interesting points, but I understand if you don't want to listen to them, so feel free to disappear and do something else if you don't want to just listen to me explaining things for a while. I'd also be interested if, because it wouldn't surprise me if people watching my things have worked with things like what I'm about to talk about. So if there are people out there who have, feel free to give me your input on these things. Feel free anyway, but it would be quite interesting if somebody has worked with this to know if I make any mistakes or anything. Please do let me know if I do, because I'm from more of an office end, but I have worked with such things, but in a very limited capacity. So anyway, let's move on with this.
But one thing we definitely need to know is you don't really need power much of the time. I imagine a machine like the STPC or the ZFX86 in a CAM environment, that's computer-aided manufacturing. One image that springs to mind are machines utilizing something like Gerber or Exelon, which are fairly simple languages used to control PCB manufacturer equipment and drills. If you did use it for something like that, you would probably design whatever you wanted, circuit boards being the example I'm going with, using a more powerful desktop computer to run your CAD software, whatever you wanted to use. At the time, this machine may have been an Athlon or a Pentium 3. Now, you could use that system to control the manufacturing directly, but with all the heat sinking in them, the higher airflow and moving parts, a design which is better optimized for less direct approaches in less hard environments, it would have probably found its life shortened significantly, not to mention introducing several other impracticalities and inefficiencies. I mean, you don't really want to run Windows 2000 to control the equipment, and it doesn't really work as well. It's not really intended for that. The equipment probably relies on interfaces like RS-232, which benefit from the direct hardware access which Windows 2000 XP don't provide. So, yeah, really, there's no advantage to running a more expensive, more powerful machine. You don't need it, and probably not certified to run in that environment, and there's nothing but disadvantages and increased costs, really. It's not a sensible thing to do. So instead, you'd be exporting your work from the more powerful machine and bringing it in the more simple formats like Gerber and Exelon to a system like the STPC, the ITOX Star, to control the manufacturing of the boards. The computer is low power and low airflow, so leaving all day in a dusty environment is reasonably inconsequential. An operating system like DOS or QNX is more than adequate for something like this as well, so the fact the computer isn't very powerful at the time is likely going to go widely unnoticed because it simply doesn't matter, and the benefit outweighs the costs. And as I said, I also believe they were used for thin clients, terminals, things like that. Point of sale wouldn't at all surprise me, which it would have probably allowed for significant cost reductions in some environments, or else kept the more expensive, more advanced computers out of a harsh environment that these might have worked in. Then there's the replacement market. Now, if you look up the ZFX86, such things can cost quite a lot of money, likely as solutions such as the AT form factor motherboard here are made for replacement parts. The ZFX86 processor itself is actually quite cheap, and I'm surprised nobody's tried making their own boards with it yet. I remember suggesting it to someone on a forum once, and maybe someday it'll happen, but I seem to think the guy I suggested it to didn't like it and didn't really have the facilities to work with such complicated boards. Meanwhile, the AT boards that are around tend to be extortionate in cost, but again, the benefit outweighs the cost. It's a bit of a rip-off, but they know they can get away with it. Now, imagine then you have a production line making something in high volume. It could be anything. I don't know, let's say rubber chickens, right? The world needs rubber chickens. Now, let's imagine that those rubber chickens are your own design, and your production line was purpose-built to make them, which it quite possibly was. How much did the production line cost to create in total? How much do you make from the chickens you make every day, and how much do you lose if that production breaks down? Again, it comes down to the benefit outweighs the cost. Custom moulding or tooling or whatever the hell you're doing, well, yeah, these such things don't come cheap. That it would have cost a lot to put that stuff there. Now, let's just say everything's going fine for a minute. Your controllers are on custom ISA cards. They've been there for 25 years. Chicken output's at peak production. Such things aren't as uncommon as you'd think. I mean, I know there are numerous factories not that far from here. There are some still using 286 SBCs from nearly 30 years ago, and they won't change them because, well, they're doing the job they're supposed to do. But in this example, let's say these machines are doing what they're supposed to do, and then it breaks. Crap. Now what? What do you do now? Well, you could go out and buy a new computer, because you're sure as hell not going to be able to just get your hands on another one of those motherboards that you had in there. I mean, that thing's like 25 years old. I've heard the Celeron's quite cheap, but it's not certified to run in that under those conditions. Really, the system you're buying, in all likelihood. And you have to lose those custom controller cards now. And yeah, now the software to run everything that was developed just for your factory alone doesn't work. And, well, your entire production line is pretty much useless at this point. Yep, that $150 Celeron machine isn't so cheap after all, because now you've got to replace a significant amount of your production system, if not the whole thing. At the very least, those controller cards. And all this time, you're not making rubber chickens, so your company is just bleeding money all over the place, as well as paying to needlessly develop those replacement parts for the production line that still works and has nothing wrong with it in the first place. Just a failure of a chipset on a motherboard somewhere. Software licensing's also going to catch up with you, because, well, that's nothing comes with no strings attached, and yeah, that's going to run up a bill before you could even think of turning things back on. Now, you can complete the work, but you've got to send your workers away for training on how to use this new system and this new software. And you're still not making any chickens in this time, so yeah, you aren't making money, which, given the prime function of any business is to make money, it's a rather monumental problem, I think you would agree. You can find new motherboards with anything from Atoms to i7s that offer ISA, but they cost a lot of money and don't really offer proper DMA, and there are often other features missing from them which your controllers more than likely require. In fact, I seem to think I read something about the military somewhere having an issue with this. I can't remember whose military or what it was, but yeah, it wouldn't surprise me. I mean, this is a problem. It does exist in places. So, yeah, either way, such machines are out of the question. You're not going to be using one of these i7 ISA boards in that kind of setting. Not going to happen. So now we've stopped and thought about this properly. Yeah, it seems that replacement 486 motherboard is a few hundred dollars, but you can plug everything straight back into it, and the software's going to come straight back up, and the production line's going to restart. Very minimal work by comparison. It's going to be like nothing happened very quickly. In that situation, the board practically pays for itself several times over because, well, you're not having to replace all that expensive production line now, all that those custom controller cards that you would have had to have developed, that software you would have had to have written and licensed, and all that training you would have had to do. It's all to do with supply and demand, and the benefit outweighing the cost again. You get the picture. So in some ways, the 486 is still alive and well to this day. There's a lot of them in use. In fact, I got this one recently, which seems to have only just been taken out of an active roll somewhere, and it has dust bunnies the size of elephants in it, and it needs cleaning. I'm going to upload a video of that unlisted, and I'll post it up in the What Have You Messed With thread on my forum for anyone who's interested. Still, it kind of is odd to consider that anything you buy that came from a well-established production line, be it a tin of beans or a video card, might well have passed by a 486 at some point in its creation. It's also really interesting to think, looking back, that whilst we content ourselves with Palominos, Hammers and Prescotts, that a completely different world was passing by mostly unnoticed. A completely different class of machines, which may well have been at the heart of constructing those very systems that overshadowed them.
So, I mean, it's interesting in many ways, in my mind. The STPC, going back to that, it's a really cool piece of kit. I really, really like it. I want to make a casing for it and everything. And I kind of wonder, because it's so small and low power, that we might be able to actually make it run on batteries. And if we use 90 degree risers for the slots, we'd probably make it very compact. Maybe even integrate a 4-inch LCD, as I have a couple of them around somewhere. That'd be pretty cool. It could make like some really dodgy little portable computer or something. I don't know if it'll ever happen, but it's an idea that's been in the back of my mind. Maybe someday we'll give it a go. Now, there is one last thing I want to point out, though, really, because, you know, if you've stayed with me this long, I don't know how long this is turning out, but, yeah, it's... I said a long time ago how it was ahead of the curve and stuff, and you might be there thinking now, well, this is just a weaker version of the Media GX. And in a way, you're not entirely wrong on that. In fact, you are like 99% correct. It sort of is. But I think the problem with the Media GX was that Cyrix targeted the wrong place. The Media GX was aimed at people at home, so we didn't really want it. It didn't do all that well, because things like the Pentium MX and the K6 were getting dirt cheap very quickly, and so it just kind of got left behind, and yeah, it was a shame. I like Cyrix, but yeah, they messed up on that one, we've got to be honest. But I did also say there were differences between them, and one which is very much in favour of the STPC. And if we bring up the data sheets, it seems, unless I'm wrong, that the video controller on the STPC is much more tightly integrated than it is on the Media GX. The Media GX is close, but it doesn't seem quite as close-knit, and it seems to be a little ways away from the CPU core and the memory by comparison. The STPC pretty much slaps the video controller straight on the CPU's own 64-bit bus, and yeah, it's sat there before the RAM and everything. It's kind of on an equal footing with that, and that's quite impressive. It's a bad example of it, unfortunately, because they didn't make that video controller particularly fast, and I doubt they needed to. I mean, on my board, it defaults to 512K of shared memory, and yeah, it's obviously probably just designed to run text mode, and that's probably all it would have needed to do, or a monochrome interface. You know, if it was graphical, I don't think there was any need for performance on there, and I very much doubt it's what they were aiming for. But if we bring up the data sheet for the Atom E3800, which was the first one I thought of, and it's only 2 or 3 years old, the Atom 3800, it's a very recent processor by comparison, and look at the logical block diagram. The layout, the concept appears, yeah, there's a strikingly resemblance there to the STPC, I think you would agree. So the concept was definitely on the ball. Now if we look at other SoCs from the STPC's time, because they weren't the only ones, we know Cyrix made the Media GX, it's kind of amusing how the STPC's on a licensed Cyrix core, which Cyrix probably didn't get much of anything for, and it probably did better than theirs, even though we never really heard of it. And yeah, if we look at them data sheets, well, yeah, the AMD ELAN, which was their 486 core, doesn't have anywhere near as good an integration as the STPC. It also has very limited ISA implementation. It just generally doesn't seem to be quite as much there as the STPC. I'm not anywhere near as far along. So I don't really think AMD were quite on the ball with that. it probably did all right, but I've not seen one in use. I don't doubt they're out there. I've heard of them being used, but yeah, it doesn't look much like that Atom, let's put it that way. External video as well on those, that was slapped the other side of the PCI bus, so quite clumsy. There's also an RDC, which I've been able to find very little about, but it's remarked that they have less I.O. and the ISI implementation was really quite limited. So, yeah, STPC, it seems, was the better one out of the bunch in its own time. There probably were things that came later that improved upon it. I know ST made their own more powerful chip at some point, the STPC Vega, which was based on the Rise MP6, which would make sense in that environment because it's a very low power chip. And so, yeah, that's likely where, yeah, I don't think it was just an MP6. I think it was an MP6 core with other bits, basically the STPC with an MP6 core instead, as far as I can tell. So, yeah, these things have a place, and obviously because the Atom has done very well for Intel.
Now, as it turns out, using the Atom 3800 as my example was probably a good thing. I mean, it was just the first data sheet I came across there, and it seemed like the right class of processor to be a modern equivalent to the STPC. And, well, if you actually look on DFI's website, yes, DFI are still there, they still make motherboards. They just make commercial boards and not consumer ones, but hey, they're still there. Well, yeah, there's this little SBC here, and it uses an Atom 3800, and I guess that motherboard would really be the present-day equivalent of the iTox Star. So, yeah, you know, if there is a market for these things, there is a place for them in the world. They have work that has to be done. They do important things. You know, there is a need for them, there is a requirement for them, and, well, they're still around. And I guess that's today's answer to the iTox Star, as it were. Kind of neat, really, isn't it? And, yeah, I'll probably leave a link to the pages in the description if you want to go and have a look at those things. It's a really neat-looking board. I'm not going to get one, because, well, they're not cheap, I wouldn't think, and I have no use for it, but these things are nice to look at. I like to look at these things. Well, anyway, I'll get back to the video, I guess. There's no point me sitting here all day. Anyway, I've got stuff to do.
But it's also worth noting that my own Atom, which is a Model 330, and it's from a decade after the STPC, 2009, I think my Atom, 2008 maybe, so it's nigh on a decade, and the integration on it's not actually as good. It was one of the first Atoms, I think it was one of within the first two models that ever came out. And so, yeah, that's quite impressive when you actually stop and think about it, that in some ways we have beaten 2008, 2009 machines with 90s technology, if only a little bit. Of course, the STPC is very slow and inefficient by comparison, I would think. Clock for clock, it's not going to be as efficient on power dissipation as an Intel Atom. But that's, yeah, I think that's cool. You know, they were definitely there with the concept. And it's kind of weird when you think about it. I lost my place. Where was I? I'm not doing another take. I'm not doing another take. I refuse. I've done like 20 of the bloody things. And I have remembered my place. I apologise for that. I like having cuts in my videos, but sometimes they have to be. It's a lot to keep in my head in one go. So, yeah, what I was going to say is that the other kind of, I think, worth mentioning kind of thing is that the Atom, which obviously is built on the concept of the STPC, ST don't seem to make these things really so much now, is in smartphones now. They use it in cell phones, which is kind of neat. So I guess the STPC is kind of the granddaddy of some of these modern phones, right? It's the same concept, and, well, there wasn't really you know, it wasn't such a big thing back then when it was around. So, yeah, I guess they were kind of on track there, even if they weren't aware of it. Also, that operating system I was running, which seems to be the one that got run on the STPC a lot, QNX, which I'm going to have to play with. It's a fascinating operating system. Very lightweight. I rather like it in just the little experience I've had. I don't know what use I could possibly have for it, but I think I like it. BlackBerry 10. Anyone ever heard of, used BlackBerry 10? It's based on QNX. Kind of cool, right? Kind of, yeah, now we're kind of getting there. And ST do have their hands in the cell phone market as well, although I'm not sure what they make for them. I know they've made wireless components in the past, so I wouldn't be surprised if they were probably making Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, things like that, or who knows what. But yeah, that seems to be where it's culminated, this stuff. So I guess its legacy is still on the go, in a way. So yeah, you've probably never heard of the thing, but you've probably unknowingly had something to do with one, or had something to do with its lineage, as it were, I guess you would say, in a way, even if indirectly. It's also odd to think, really, when you think back to what I said about factories and such, that if you buy anything off of an established production line, it might have passed by a 486 at some point, because, like I say, it's not that uncommon for them to still be working. I've actually got a 486SX recently that only just came out of working. So, yeah, you know, they are still out there. They're still going, a lot of them. And it's also, when we actually step back and look at it, kind of amazing to think that we've just had a bit of a look into a completely different world of computers that is often not known about, but it's there and it's important, and in the case of the STPC, might well have been very instrumental in building the very machines that overshadowed it. No, it's just a thought, right? I mean, it may have been on a... they may have used them on the line for making motherboards. I wouldn't be at all surprised to find out that some of them were. But who knows? Who knows where mine came from? I honestly have no idea. But anyway, I'm high treason. I'm amazed you've stuck around for as long. But seeing as you did, thanks for watching, and I'll see you again soon. Seems everybody has a stupid phrase at their end of the videos, doesn't it? And I should get one of those just to make my channel worse. Yeah, I'm out of here. Remember, if it don't run DOS, I don't give a toss. How's that? It was terrible. I'll never do that again. I'll see you around.